Families. My name is Mallory Hammond. I'm the Director of Kids and Families here at Christ Presbyterian Church. Our vision in kids ministry is to partner with parents in raising the next generation for a lifetime of knowing God, experiencing His love, and following Christ and His mission. This month, I wanted to specifically chat with you guys about an area involved in raising the next generation. When I lived in New York City for the first time, I moved the summer after my junior year of college to study acting for a summer. This is going to be the longest I've ever been away from home, away from my routine and support and community. And because I was endlessly optimistic and naive, I was so sure that this little Alabama girl would have no problem navigating the big city. I was not, at the time, what you would call a problem solver, attentive to details, or known to think through consequences of my happy, floaty little actions. Because I'd always experienced being rescued by people around me who were super competent, type A, and who loved me. I'll never forget the moment I finally made it to my dorm on the day I arrived. I navigated the LaGuardia Airport for the first time, and I only got lost twice. I hailed my first cab. No, it was not the Yellow City cab, but a creepy one you aren't supposed to get in because it inflates the rates to take advantage of suckers like me. And I stepped out onto the curb holding all of my bags, moments from throwing my red hat in the air, Mary Tyler Moore style, because I was having my first resident New Yorker moment. I took a deep breath. It smelled terrible, but I wasn't going to lose this romantic moment with the city, and I turned to face my NYU dorm. And it was locked, and my arms were full of bags. And there was no way for me to get in. And the person working at the desk was ignoring me, I'm sure thinking I was a tourist. And I felt lost. What do I do? I felt legitimately stuck. And then I saw this nice boy walking through the lobby towards the door. And I thought, thank goodness, he's going to help me. He'll hold the door. He'll let me in. Wrong. He opened the door, bumped into me, causing me to drop all of my bags in gross brown New York City curb puddles, and told me explicitly how much I was in his way. And the door slammed behind him. So sitting on the curb with my soaked bags and bruised feelings, this is the first moment I realized I was going to have to figure out how to do things for myself to survive this summer. I think we can all relate to someone in my story. My friends and family all loved me and knew I was a little bit of a lovable mess. It was easier to swoop in and save me than to watch me flounder. It has taken a lot of formative and sometimes tough experiences to teach me to faithfully persevere through my idol of comfort. So there's a movement in parenting right now called lawnmower parenting. Lawnmower parents mow down all of children's challenges, discomforts, and struggles. The problem is not a parent's willingness to help a child succeed. That's compassionate and human. The problem comes from a parent's repeated efforts to eliminate any and all struggle for their children. And while this may seem to have short-term benefits, the problem is that all too often, children who have been lawnmower parented are ill-equipped to deal with the challenge of life when they grow up and life inevitably goes sideways. So my friend, church member, and pre-K teacher, Lee Graham, wrote an incredible article that we'll link in the newsletter that talks about methods of building problem solving through risky play for kids. In her article, Ms. Graham says, "We all want our children to be comfortable, happy, and successful. However, Jesus told us our lives would be the exact opposite when he said in John 16:33, in this world you will have trouble. And as parents and teachers, we are called to prepare the children entrusted to us to engage with a world that is fallen and full of dangers and disappointments and disasters. We are called to instill in them the knowledge that this world is not our true home. And how will children be prepared for these inevitable hard things if they're not allowed to experience anything? So allowing a little risk during playtime is a great way to teach kids to problem solve. Because so often on a playground, kids will climb a ladder and realize they're higher than they imagined, and then they'll freeze. And if you're standing nearby coaching them and encouraging them to climb back down themselves, rung by rung, it allows them to problem solve and then tuck that experience away to use as a teacher for the future when they feel stuck. And an added bonus in this scenario is kids love seeing adults trust them. Natural consequences are another excellent teacher. Of course, we're not looking to manufacture consequences to be punitive, but even if it's painful to watch your child receive tardies at school, the most effective way to help them learn the importance of managing their time is to allow them to receive the school's consequences for that infraction. This experience will go so much farther because it will serve as a tool in their tool belt for the future. As parents and a church family, we want to celebrate successes and show grace in failure for our kids. We have to care about kids where they are now, but also keep a long-term view on helping them grow into healthy, mature disciples. Matthew 7:11 is a great encouragement to me, and I hope it is to you. If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who's in heaven give good things to those who ask for him? Our Father in heaven loves your kiddos even better than we ever could. He didn't even withhold pain and suffering from his own son in order to reconcile himself to you and your family. We can trust him even with our greatest treasures, your kids. Thanks for hanging out with me. I'll see you soon. Bye.